long ago. A child will come to bring us hope. Star lit up the night to show. Men seeking truth, the child came as living proof. Light of all the world still shines today. In a lowly cattle stall, love was born to save us all. It's a season of hope, a season of Christmas cheer. People try to hide their fear. Many hungry hearts are lost and cold.
They are lost and cold.
But we can be the light of Christ. Bring some joy to someone's life. Share the greatest story. A season of hope, a season of joy, and it all goes back to a baby boy. When God reached down and changed the world forever, we can reach out, we can be. Season of hope, a season of joy, and it all goes back to a baby boy when God reached down and changed the world forever. We can reach out, we can believe in the power of love. We can change the world.
lights of the city shine bright red and green, but sometimes the season is not what it seems. In heartache or joy, let me rest in your care. Be near me, Lord Jesus, this is my Christmas prayer. The wise men brought treasures, the shepherds bowed down. Angels were singing their glorious sound. I have no great riches, no gift to impart. What can I give you? Lord, I will give my heart. Be near me, Lord Jesus, I ask you to stay. Close by me forever, I pray. Through the storm, through the night, hold me close, be my light, show the way. Bless all of your children, we need your embrace. We hunger for mercy and long for your grace. Our grateful devotion is all we can bring. We praise you, we bless you, Jesus, our Savior and King. Be near me, Lord Jesus, I ask you to stay. Close by me forever, I pray. Through the storm, through the night, hold me close, be my light. Oh. Oh. Through the storm, through the night, hold me close, be my light. Great is the gift just to know you are there. Be near me, Lord Jesus. Be near me, Lord Jesus. This is my Christmas prayer.
Good morning and welcome to Praise Baptist Center's online service. Let us be reminded of our vision statement, Go and Make Disciples, and our mission statement, rooted in the word, sharing the gospel. Online prayer meetings are on Wednesdays, 8:30 p.m., and online life groups are on Thursdays, 8:30 p.m. Information regarding tithes and offerings have been provided in the PBC official chat group. If you need further information, please contact Sister Fong Ping. Pastor Stephen Gaines is an American Southern Baptist pastor and the 61st president of the Southern Baptist Convention. He is currently serving at Bellevue Baptist Church in Cordova, one of the largest congregations in the Southern Baptist Convention. Today, he will be sharing with us a message on the seriousness of soul winning. Thank you for listening and may you be blessed.
Take your Bibles and turn with me, please, to Ezekiel chapter 3. Ezekiel chapter 3. Ezekiel, you need to read that book. When you get to heaven, a man will walk up to you and say, "How'd you like my book?" And you'll say, "What's your name?" And he'll say, "Ezekiel." And you'll say, "It was great. It was wonderful." Ezekiel chapter 3, in just a moment, I'll be reading from verse 1. Back when I was in Texas as a pastor, I was 25 years old when I began to pastor. I'm 61 now, so that's been 36 years ago. And I remember going out one afternoon, on a Sunday afternoon, we had had somebody visit the church that morning, and I took two of my guys, they were both on the finance committee, one of them was chairman of the deacon body, and so we went out, and they wanted to go visiting, but I wanted to go soul winning. How many of you know there's a difference? There's a difference between going and inviting people to church, and there's also inviting people to Jesus. And so we got out there and we talked a little bit. And after about 10 minutes of small talk, I was like Popeye. I'd had all I could stands no more. And I was ready to tell somebody about Jesus. And so I just jumped in there and I asked them, "Hey, let me ask you a question. If you were to die today, do you know for certain that if you were to die today that you'd go to heaven?" And boy, I mean, their eyes opened up. We'd been talking about football and this, that, and other. And all of a sudden, now we're talking about their soul. And they said, "Well, we don't really know." And I said, "Well, let's say you did die and you stood before God and you were to ask him, why should I let you into heaven? What would you say to God?" And they said, "We don't know. We don't know what we would say." And so I shared the gospel with them, went all through the gospel. And at the end, I said, "Would you like to repent of your sins? And would you like to believe in Jesus and receive him as your Lord and Savior?" They said, "We're just not ready to do that yet." And I did what I always do. I backed up and shared a little bit more and gave them one more shot. And they said, "No, we're just not ready." I said, "Okay." We prayed with them. We left. Got in the car, and my two buddies were quiet all the way back to the church. And right when we were about to turn into the church parking lot, one of them said, "Preacher, don't you think you're a little pushy back there?" And I told him, I said, I understand your concern. But I want you to go home, and I want you this afternoon, before you come back to church tonight, I want you to read Ezekiel chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. I just want you to read that three or four times and really let it sink in. See what the Lord says to you, and we'll talk after I preach tonight, okay? They said, "Okay." And so they did, and they came back into my office that night after service, and they kind of looked at me and they said, "We get it. We know why you did what you did. And we'll never go visiting again. When we go, we'll go soul winning." We're in a month that we're going to emphasize soul winning. We're going to emphasize who's your one. More about that later. But we're going to ask you to pray for lost people. We're going to ask you to witness to lost people. We're going to ask you, even if you've never done it before, we pray that before the end of this year, you will have the privilege of sharing Jesus with somebody and watch them get saved right in front of you. And I want to say this to you, there's nothing like that. Nothing like that. I saw four kids born. That's great. That was wonderful. Praise God. But I want to say this to you, as glorious as that was, seeing somebody get saved right in front of you is even more glorious than seeing a child born. God wants to save people. The reason people are not getting saved is not because God didn't predestine them to get saved. The reason people are not getting saved is because you and I have blood on our hands. That's what we're going to talk about today. We have not shared the gospel with people. We have not given them the opportunity to say yes or no to Jesus Christ. And their blood is on our hands. And when we stand before God, we're going to have to give an account for that. I must warn lost people with the gospel. I must warn them, or their blood will be on my hands when I stand before the Lord. Let's talk just a moment about the seriousness of soul winning. Ezekiel 3, look at verse 1. And he said to me, "Son of man, eat what is before you, eat this scroll, and go and speak to the house of Israel." So I opened my mouth and he gave me the scroll to eat. Then he said to me, "Son of man, eat this scroll I'm giving you, and fill your stomach with it." So I ate it, and it tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth. He then said to me, "Son of man, go now to the house of Israel and speak my words to them. You are not being sent to a people of obscure speech and difficult language, but to the house of Israel, not to many peoples of obscure speech and difficult language whose words you cannot understand. Surely, if I had sent you to them, they would have listened to you. But the house of Israel is not willing to listen to you because they are not willing to listen to me. For the whole house of Israel is hardened and obstinate, but I will make you as unyielding and hardened as they are. I will make your forehead like the hardest stone. That was the first hard-headed preacher right there. Amen. Harder than flint. Do not be afraid of them or terrified by them, though they are a rebellious house. And he said to me, Son of man, listen carefully and take heart to all the words I speak to you. Go now to your countrymen in exile. Speak to them. Say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says, whether they listen or fail to listen. Then the Spirit of the Lord lifted me up. I heard behind me a loud rumbling sound. May the glory of the Lord be praised in his dwelling place forever. He had a little fit right there in the middle of verse 12. Verse 13, the sound of the wings of the living creatures brushing against each other and the sound of the wheels beside them, a loud rumbling sound. The Spirit then lifted me up and took me away, and I went in bitterness and in the anger of my spirit with the strong hand of the Lord upon me. I came to the exiles who lived at Tel Abib near the Kibar River. And there where they were living, I sat among them for 7 days, overwhelmed. At the end of 7 days, the word of the Lord came to me. And here's what I told those two guys to read back in Lake Dallas 36 years ago. Verse 17, Son of man, this is God speaking to Ezekiel. Son of man, I have made you a watchman. Everybody say watchman. I've made you a watchman for the house of Israel, so hear the word I speak and give them warning from me. When I say to a wicked man, you will surely die, and you do not warn him or speak out to dissuade him from his evil ways in order to save his life, that wicked man will die for his sin, and I will hold you accountable for his blood. Literally, his blood will be on your hands. Verse 19, but if you do warn the wicked man and he does not turn from his wickedness or from his evil ways, he will die for his sin, but you will have saved yourself. Did you catch that? I'm sending you to speak a message. If you share it and they discard it, they will die in their sin, but their blood won't be on your hand. But if you don't share it, if you don't tell them the word that I give you, for us, that would be the gospel. They will die in their sin. But their blood will be upon your hand. If you look on our bulletin, there's a set of hands. Do your hands have blood on them? When you stand before God, do you have blood on your hands? Because there are people, not that you did not lead to the Lord, but you did not share the gospel with them. Listen to me. Once you share the gospel, it's up to them. But if you don't share the gospel, it's up to you. Let's talk a little bit about the seriousness of soul winning. The soul winner is appointed by God. A lot of times people say, who gives you the right to tell me what to do? Jesus. He appoints all of us. Look at verse 17. Son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel. Son of man, a common reference to a mere man in the Old Testament. Jesus used that same phrase to refer to himself so frequently. He was not only the Son of God, he was perfect God, but he was also perfect man. It's a reference just to being a human being. It emphasized Ezekiel's mortality, his finiteness compared to the Lord's immortality and his infiniteness. I've made you a watchman for the house of Israel, a watchman, a sentinel on a wall. He would guard the city, and they had 24-hour-a-day sentinels, 24-hour-a-day watchmen. And if he saw an enemy coming, he would announce, and the city would prepare themselves to defend themselves against people who would come against them. Ezekiel was a spiritual watchman over the people of Israel. He was a renowned prophet. He was not watching out for the physical enemies of God's people. He was watching out for the spiritual enemies of God's people, a lot like a pastor does nowadays. He is a shepherd watching out for the wolves that would attack the sheep. He wasn't concerned about them being attacked physically. He was concerned about how their souls would be attacked by the devil. He was interested in their souls. And Jesus, you might remember, said in Mark 8:36, "What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? What will a man give in exchange for his soul?" I got news for you. You are not a body with a soul. You are a soul with a body. Your soul will live forever. Your body is going down. If you don't believe that, go buy a real mirror. I mean a big one. And look into it and see if that is what it used to be. And if you're honest, you'll say, you know what? This tent is perishing, but my soul gets better and better. Praise God, God will raise up the body. But aren't you glad that you have a soul and you can give your soul to Jesus Christ? We need to be soul winners. We are watchmen looking after souls. Is that not what Jesus said to his disciples when he called them? He had already met the fishermen back in John chapter 1, but now in Matthew 4, he calls them out away from fishing to do another kind of work, to be watchmen, if you will, watchers of souls. Matthew 4, verse 18 and following, as Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, and they were fishermen. "Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men," Jesus said. At once they left their nets and they followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, and they were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. Jesus called them. Immediately they left the boat, they left the nets, they left their father, and they followed Jesus. Every time I go to the Sea of Galilee, I try to remember this incident, and I think about those men. Like I said, they'd already met Jesus, if you read back in John chapter 1, but now they're called by the Lord to be fishers of men, to be watchmen over the souls of mankind, to be concerned about somebody's soul, not just your body. Praise God for doctors, but we need more than doctors. We need people who are watchmen over our souls. They were fishing for fish, but Jesus said, no, we're going to fish for souls. We're going to be spiritual watchmen. And it's the same thing. When you get saved, guess what? You become a watchman. A watchman watches over the souls of other people. Immediately after you have Jesus come into your life, you are to share Jesus with lost people. I mean, and really, if you think about it, you'll have more lost people connected to you right when you get saved than any other time. There's probably not a better time in your whole life to share the gospel than right when you get saved, because you know people that are lost. Hear me today. God's calling you. Hear the words of the Lord today. He's not just speaking to Ezekiel. Jesus was not just speaking to Peter and Andrew, James and John. I'm telling you, you look at me, he's talking to you right now. It's not good enough just to give an offering to support the preachers and the others that share the gospel. You've got to start sharing the gospel. You're a fisher of men. Follow Jesus. Be a fisher of men. Jesus said in Matthew 28, 19 to 20, "Therefore go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you, and surely I'll be with you always to the very end of the age." Acts 1:8, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem," that was the town where they were, "in Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." And Paul said in Romans 1:16, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it's the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then also to the Gentile. Just apply all those words to you. Jesus is calling you today. Jesus is appointing you today. Jesus is saying, follow me, and don't just follow me to have some Bible studies. Don't just follow me to read some books. Don't just follow me to gain some knowledge. Don't just follow me to be nice and moral. All of that's great. All that's wonderful. But follow me to be a fisher of men. Follow me to win souls. Follow me to be a watchman for the souls of mankind. Follow me so that we can go out here and before we die, before you die, you can win some people to the Lord. Isn't that what you want? How many of you know lost people? How many of you know anybody that's lost? Raise your hand. How many of you got lost people in your family? Raise your hand. How many of you got lost people you work with? Anybody out there? How many of you got lost people you go to school with? Anybody out there? All right, look at me. How many of you got lost people that are neighbors? Does anybody even know their neighbors? Anybody know their neighbors out there? Yeah. We live in a mission field. Jesus has appointed us to be a soul winner. But not only are we appointed by God, but we are supposed to actually speak. Now listen to what I'm about to say. We are to speak on behalf of God. Can you even fathom that? I mean, why doesn't God just, I mean, could God just speak from heaven? He's done it a few times. Why does he? I don't know why, but God uses redeemed humanity to share the good news of Jesus Christ with lost people. And so, second point is this, the soul winner is not only appointed by God, but he announces for God. When you share the gospel, you are actually speaking on behalf of Almighty God. That's a heavy thing. That's a heavy thing. Look at verse 17. It ends by saying, so hear the word that I speak, Ezekiel, and give them warning from me. Two things here. Hear the word, give them warning. Hear the word. Hear the word of God, and then share the word of God. Two things. Constantly the word is coming in. Constantly the word is going out. Constantly the Word of God is going in. I'm reading the Word. I'm studying the Word. I'm memorizing the Word. I'm hearing the Word taught. And then I'm going to share the Word. I'm not going to just bottle it up. I'm going to share it. I'm not going to just take it in. I'm going to let it go. I'm going to tell somebody about the Lord. Hear the Word that I speak and give them warning from me. And once he had done that, once he had warned the people, their blood was no longer on his hands. Now, I want to say this to you. He warned them. Nowadays, people just want to be encouraged and consoled. They want to come to church and just hear a little sermonette from a preacherette to Christianettes. But I got news for you. That's what's wrong with America. We don't need any more sermonettes. We don't need any preacherettes. We need some prophets, amen, that will get up and say, here's the Word of God. Here's the Word of God. And I'm not trying to grandstand, and I'm not trying to put myself in a good position. I'm just telling you, if you'll preach the Bible, people will accuse you of being smart, amen? The Bible is the message that the world needs. We desperately need Bible preachers. I'm praying for God to raise up thousands, if not tens of thousands, of gospel preachers that will preach the Word of God. Let me tell you something. There's not anything going on in our country that a lot of gospel preaching and gospel sharing couldn't fix real quick. If we would speak up, things would change very quickly. But we hold the gospel to ourselves. These people to whom Ezekiel would speak, they didn't need pampering. They needed admonishing. They didn't need to be consoled. They needed to be rebuked. They had sin in the camp. Go back to what he said earlier, Ezekiel 3, verses 1 and following. He said to me, this is Ezekiel talking, son of man, eat what is before you. Eat this scroll. He's talking about the Word of God. Take it in. Consume it. And then go and speak to the house of Israel. Notice that. Take it in. Hear the Word of God and then share it. Hear the Word of God and share it. read the word of God and then share it. Verse 2, I opened my mouth. He gave me the scroll to eat. He said to me, son of man, eat this scroll I'm giving you. Fill your stomach with it. I mean, don't get just a little. It's not just a little dab will do you. The word of God, you need a big chunk of it every day. Fill your stomach with it. So I ate it, and it tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth. I got up early this morning, and I was in the book of Psalms, and I was reading, and I was just going through Psalm 63, and it was like sweetness to me. It was like honey in my mouth. I was over reading over in Isaiah chapter 26, and it was like honey in my mouth. I was over in 2 Corinthians. It was like honey in my mouth. I got news for you. The Word of God is sweet when you're hungry for the spiritual food that God wants to give you. Then he says, he then said to me, son of man, go now to the house of Israel and speak my words to them. You're not being sent to a people of obscure speech. I'm not calling you to be a foreign missionary, Ezekiel. I'm not sending you to somebody with difficult language, but to the house of Israel, not to many peoples of obscure speech and difficult language. Nothing wrong with foreign missions, but that's not your call. Those words, whose words you cannot understand. Surely if I had sent you to those people, they would have listened to you. But the house of Israel is not willing to listen to you because they're not willing to listen to me. For the whole house of Israel is hardened and obstinate, but I will make you as unyielding and hardened as they are. I will make your forehead like the hardest stone, harder than flint. Don't be afraid of them. Don't be terrified of them. They are a rebellious house. And he said to me, son of man, listen carefully and take to heart all the words I speak to you. Go now to your countrymen in exile. Speak to them. Say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says, whether they listen or fail to listen, announce the word of God. One of the most wicked kings in the Old Testament was a guy named Ahab. And he was living in the day when Israel and Judah were split. Ahab was a wicked man in and of itself, but it was compiled when he married a woman named Jezebel. You know, when you say that word, don't you just kind of, it's kind of like Cruella de Vil. You remember that lady? By the way, Cruella de Vil, that's cruel devil, by the way. Just a little word for you there, all right? But Jezebel, when you say Jezebel, I mean, nowadays people even talk about a Jezebel spirit, a rebellious spirit. And this was a wicked man, and he hated the prophets of God. His wife killed a lot of the prophets of God. But there was still a few of them left, and one of them was named Micaiah, not Micah, but Micaiah. And we don't know much about him, but he was a man of God. And Jehoshaphat and Ahab were together, and Ahab was saying, we need to go attack these people over here. Will you go with me? And Jehoshaphat, like he always did, said, oh, okay. Jehoshaphat was a sweet, godly man, but he wasn't real bright when it came to hooking up with the wrong people. How many of you know that if you get with the wrong people, you're going to do the wrong thing? Anybody know that? And so Jehoshaphat said, okay. And Jehoshaphat said, hey, before we go, can we hear from the prophets? So all these paid for, sold out, ungodly prophets came over and said, oh, yes, go, you will win the victory. And finally, Jehoshaphat realizes that these guys are just bought and paid for by Ahab and Jezebel. Is there not one prophet of the Lord in our midst? Is there not one man of God who will tell us what God says? Good question. Good question. And Ahab said, yeah, I got one, but I hate him because he always says bad things about me. I don't like him because he doesn't give me a feel-good sermon. And Jehoshaphat basically said, shut your mouth. Send for him. And they went, and the guy that went there said, hey, notice what he says. 1 Kings 22. The messenger who went to summon Micaiah, spoke to him, saying, behold, now the words of the prophets, those are the false prophets, are uniformly favorable to the king. Please let your word be like the word of one of them and speak favorably. Listen, Micaiah, go along to get along, son. I'm telling you, you're never going to have a good ministry. You're never going to grow a church if you just preach negative stuff. Stop. You need to go with the guys here that are health, wealth, prosperity. Everything's going to be okay. Just go along to get along. What does it really matter? Everybody else is doing it. Why don't you? And I love what Micaiah said. How many of you know that some people can't be bought out? Amen? But Micaiah said, as the Lord lives. I want to tell you something. When a real prophet said that, you better watch out what's coming next. As the Lord lives, what the Lord says to me, that I will speak. You know the rest of the story. He goes out there to Ahab and Jehoshaphat. He says, Ahab says, well, how about it, Micaiah? Are we going to be okay in the battle? He says, oh, yeah, go ahead, live. Everything's going to be okay. And he did it in a sarcastic way because Ahab said, how many times do I have to tell you to tell me the truth? He said, okay, I'll tell you the truth. I'll tell you the truth. I looked up into heaven and I saw the angels of God and the demons and everybody else up there running around. And God was saying, how can I deceive the king of Israel? Talking about Ahab. And one said this, and finally a deceiving spirit said, I'll put a deception in the mouth of his prophets. And God said, that will work. And then Micaiah said, you hear the word of the Lord, you're going to die in battle. And if you don't die, God didn't send me. Do you remember what happened? He was out in battle. And the Bible says some little old random soldier had an arrow. You ever been dove hunting? You got one shell left, you just shoot it, whatever. Don't be a crow and come across if I just got one more shot, amen? You're going down. And that old boy just had one arrow and he said, well, I'll just shoot it over toward him. He's going, poof! He walks off and got home. What happened? Well, nothing. I didn't kill anybody. He didn't know it. But that arrow went right into Ahab's chest. A mortal wound. And he died. And just like another prophet had prophesied, Elijah had prophesied that the dogs would lick his blood for killing an innocent man earlier. And he died in his chariot and the dogs licked his blood. Why? Why? What is all this about? I'm simply saying Ezekiel, just like Micaiah, just like Elijah, just like Jeremiah, was called to announce for God. You know, I love everybody and I like to give good sermons. I like to, people say, oh man, Brother Steve, that was encouraging today. Oh, praise God, I'm on fire. This is awesome. I really felt good today. How many of you know that sometimes we don't need to feel good, we need to wake up to reality? If I'm on a plane that's going down, I don't want somebody to come back there and say, would you like a Diet Coke? No, I want a parachute. I want to get out of this plane. I want some help. I want somebody to come and say, we're going down. Either jump with a parachute or say your prayers and get ready to meet your God. I want to be warned, don't you? I mean, if something's coming, I want to be warned. I mean, if you're sitting in your easy chair and you're watching some movie or something and all of a sudden the tornado warning goes off, do you say, you know what, I wish that thing would stop so I could watch my movie? What you need to do is go get under a couch. Especially if you're in Texas. There's big tornadoes out there. I'm telling you, we need to warn people. We need to lovingly say, look, it's not all right. I love you too much to leave you unwarned. We can't save them, but we can warn them. And we need to tell them, yes, God loves you, but you are a sinner. I'm a sinner. And the wages of our sin is spiritual death. If we don't trust Jesus, we're going to die and go to hell. And before that, we're going to live a life wasted without Christ. If we don't trust in Christ, you can't save yourself. The best you can do is like filthy rags before God. You need the righteousness of Jesus. Jesus came to this earth, the virgin-born Son of God. He died on the cross. He was buried, but God raised him from the dead. He's alive. And now you need to repent. You need to turn from your sin and believe that Jesus did all of that for you and receive him and call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. We need to warn somebody. We need to warn somebody. We don't just need to say, I'm okay, you're okay, God's okay, it's okay, it ain't okay. People are dying and going to hell every day. And it's not okay. It's not okay with God. It shouldn't be okay with us. Sometimes we need to warn people. Well, if you're a soul winner, you're appointed by God and you're announcing for God, one more thing, and this is probably the biggest thing. You're accountable to God. The soul winner is accountable to God. Very quickly, look at verses 18 and 19. When I say to a wicked man, you'll surely die, and you don't warn him or speak out to dissuade him from his evil ways in order to save his life, that wicked man will die in his sin, and I will hold you accountable for his blood. Says a lot about God, doesn't it? God says, there's some people I want to get saved, but if you don't witness to them, they won't get saved. Now, that really messes up some people's theology. Because some people think, you know what, if God wants you to be saved, you're going to be saved no matter what. I got news for you. There are people that die and go to hell every day that God wanted to save. And they didn't get saved because their blood was on our hands because we didn't witness to them. It's not that they got saved because God predestined them not to get saved. God doesn't predestine anybody to go to hell. If they get saved, it's because we share the gospel with them and they repent. God calls them. But you can say no to God. But you can't say no to God, really, unless somebody tells you the gospel. So you're accountable to God. God was saying, yeah, they may resist my grace, but if you don't share with them, I'll hold you accountable for that person's blood. Verse 19, but if you do warn the wicked man and he does not turn from his wickedness or from his evil way, he'll die for his sin, but you will have saved yourself. The Apostle Paul, when he was talking to the pastors of Ephesus, reminded them that he had shared the gospel with everybody he could while he was over in Ephesus. He said, now I know that none of you, talking to these pastors from Ephesus, none of you among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom will ever see me again. Therefore, I declare to you today that I am innocent of the blood of all men. Say that with me. I am innocent of the blood of all men. You know why you could say that? Because everybody... But you know, some people say, well, I'll share the gospel with him if God tells me to. Paul said, I won't share the gospel with him if God tells me not to, and he'll never tell me not to. I share the gospel with everybody. Share the gospel with everybody. I asked my dad when we would go fishing, which fish do we keep? He said, if they've got eyes, keep them. And I got news for you. If they got souls, tell them about Jesus. For I have not hesitated to proclaim to you the whole will of God. Spurgeon said it this way, one of my favorite preachers. I love Charles Spurgeon. My main business is the saving of souls. This one thing I do, if I never won souls, I would sigh till I did. I would break my heart over them if I could not break their hearts. Though I can understand the possibility of an earnest sower never reaping, I cannot understand the possibility of an earnest sower being content not to reap. I cannot comprehend any one of you Christian people trying to win souls and not having results and being satisfied with the results. What he's saying is this, I can understand you sharing the gospel with somebody and they say no, but what I can't understand is you not being willing to share the gospel with them and you don't care. I don't understand that. Parents, do you have the blood of your children on your hands? Children, do you have the blood of your siblings and the blood of your parents on your hands? Employer, do you have the blood of the people that are under you at work on your hands? Worker, do you have the blood of your co-workers with you on your hands? Students, do you have the blood of the people in your school on your hands? Do you have the blood of your neighbors on your hands? Do you even know the names of your neighbors? Preacher, if you're watching by television or whatever, do you have the blood of your congregation on your hands? Congregation, do you have the blood of the community on your hands? Memphis, I wonder if their blood is on our hands. What a wretched, horrible thing it would be, and it will be, when we stand before Jesus with the blood of lost people on our hands, simply because we never made it a priority to tell people about Jesus. Go back to Ezekiel 3, 17 through 19. Would you stand with me? I want us to read this together. Before I read this, years ago I heard about a medical doctor who was a missionary, and he had a man come in that said he was blind, and he found out that he only had cataracts. He did a surgical procedure, removed the cataracts, and the guy could see. In about a week or so, he was in his office and he was doing some treatment of people. He looked out his window and he saw that man he'd removed the cataracts from. He was holding a rope. And there were 84 blind men holding on to the rope. And he walked up to the door and he said, "Now that I can see, I want all of these people to see as well." How many of you, God has given you spiritual light? He saved your soul. Anybody out there? How many of you think that other people need to be able to see? Anybody believe that? Get a rope. It's called the gospel. And bring them to the one that can heal them. That's Jesus. Let's read what I asked those two guys in Texas to read 36 years ago. Let's read Ezekiel 3, 17 through 19. Read it out loud, good and strong. "Son of man, I have appointed you a watchman to the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, warn them from me. When I say to the wicked, 'You will surely die,' and you do not warn him or speak out to warn the wicked from his wicked way that he may live, that wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. Yet if you have warned the wicked and he does not turn from his wickedness or from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity, but you have delivered yourself." Everybody look at your hands. Don't look at me. Look at your hands. Do you have blood on your hands? There's only one way to get it off. Go tell people about Jesus. Heavenly Father, help us to take this month seriously. It's not about church growth. It's not about making Bellevue bigger. It's way beyond all that stuff. This is about being a watchman over the souls of men and women, boys and girls that are on their way to hell. And there is no other option if we're going to obey you. And there's no other hope for them than the gospel. Lord, I'm asking you in Jesus' name. Lord, I'm not the soul winner I ought to be. I pray that you would help me. You said in your word, "He who wins souls is wise." Help us all to be wise and to share Jesus with lost people. Lord, we're not responsible for their response, but we are responsible for getting the gospel to them. So, Lord, we pray that you would help us. Help us, Lord, to be a soul winner. How many of you with your heads bowed right now would say, "Pastor, I want God to give me a burden for souls"? Raise your hand. Anybody out there? Amen. Father, you've seen the hands, you know the hearts, you know the heads, you know everything about us. Help us to be not just an evangelistic church that sees a lot of people baptized. Praise you for that. But Lord, let us be a soul-winning church and witness all week long, every day. In Jesus' name, if that's your prayer, say amen.
Thank you so much for watching this presentation from Bellevue Baptist Church. And you know, we want to be just like the Apostle Paul when he said in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, "I do all things for the sake of the gospel." The gospel is the good news of Jesus. That good news is just as important today as it was in the first century. And here's that good news. God loves you. He created you. He loves you with an everlasting love. But the same Bible that teaches that God loves all of us also says that we all have a problem, a spiritual problem called sin. We have all broken the laws of God. And the wages or the penalty of that sin is death, which means we're spiritually separated from God. But God refused to leave us separated from Himself. So He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, the eternal divine Son of God. He came to this earth through the womb of a virgin. He had no sin when He was born because He was born of a virgin, and He never sinned even though He was tempted just like we are. And the Bible says even though He was the sinless Son of God, He went to a cross to die an atoning sacrificial death. He died in your place and in mine. He paid not for His sins, but for your sins and mine. He had no sins. And then the Bible says He was buried because He really did die. And then He rose from the dead, bodily, victoriously, and eternally. And now He offers you, He offers everyone, the gift of eternal life. How do you receive it? First of all, you have to repent. You have to turn from your sins and turn to Jesus. And then the Bible says you have to believe. You have to believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and that He rose from the dead to give you eternal life. And then you have to receive. You have to invite Him to come into your life, to accept Him as your Lord and Savior. And the moment you do that, you become a child of God. Would you like to repent and believe and receive right now? If you would, I'd love to lead you in a prayer of commitment to do just that. Would you just bow with me and give your heart to Jesus right now? Say something like this: Dear Lord Jesus, thank You that You love me. I am a sinner. I can't save myself. You're the only Savior. I repent of my sin. I turn to You. I believe You died on the cross for me. I believe You rose from the dead. I receive You right now. Come into my life. Save me right now, Lord Jesus. Thank You. In Jesus' name, amen. Friend, if you prayed that and you were sincere, if you really repented and believed and received Christ, you're a Christian. God bless you, and thank you for watching this broadcast.
Light of the world, here to see. angels sing, praises ring to the newborn King. Peace on earth, here with us, joy awakening. At your feet we fall.
Upon